Hi, my name is Elliot Arudos from The Online Citizen, and today we are here with presidential candidate Mr. Tan Gee Say. Mr. Tan, how are you?
Good, I'm good.
Shall we begin the interview?
Yes.
Mr. Tan, can you tell us a little bit more about yourself?
I was born in 1950. Singapore was engaged in the anti-colonial struggle. There was mass unemployment, no jobs. And actually that affected my view, my world view of society as well. I saw quite a bit of injustice around. By the colonial masters, and also by lack of jobs and all that. Yeah, I came, my family was big and was poor, so we really know what it was like to be poor. I was not born with a silver spoon in the mouth. So when I say I can empathize, I really know what I'm saying, you know, empathy. And empathy for the poor, for the disadvantaged, is an important function of the important requirement of the president.
Can you tell us a bit more about your poor background?
My mother was a washerwoman. My father had operated a coffee shop too, but he stopped it and he went on as a sailor. But after 9 months, he had some illness, so he had to stay at home. So he was at home, but it was a great help, because being a washerwoman, you not only wash, you must make sure that it's ironed, it's dry, it's ironed. So my father helped out ironing the clothes. My sisters help out washing, also ironing, also drying. And also, I help out my sister in collecting and distributing the clothes. It's all in the neighborhood. So it was quite enjoyable because just going out as a young kid. I remember that when my mother was a washerwoman, she would carry me on her back, you know. There is this carrying my back by tying the sarong. She would wash and then I would just at the back, because it was quite good movement so for to keep the child awake, keep me awake. It kept me awake rather than not being involved. At least I see something going on. So it was that kind of poverty. It was living hand from hand to mouth. I remember we could survive on $5 to $10 a day. And it's always at the beginning of each school year that we run into difficulties. And we would approach friends and relatives for help, and they do help. So this is something that I really appreciated, and I think if you are poor, you know, we are poor because there's so many children, we don't have enough to go around. And however hardworking you are, like my mother was, you couldn't cope. So I think basically we were grateful for people who give us $5, $10 to buy. At the end of every school year, we have to buy new clothes, shoes for the children and textbooks. And that's how poor we were, and we were given money by friends and relatives. I think that's a rule. And my mother would always tell me, remember those days that when people come back to you, you make sure that they leave with some money in their hands, which I did. About $50 and $100 nowadays, not $5, $10 thirty, forty years ago, but now you give them $50, $100 each time they come.
So, if I may ask, how did you, from a humble background, come to where you are now? I mean, given opportunities to go overseas and study, and then becoming principal private secretary in Kuo Chiap Tau, how did this?
Well, I worked hard, obviously, and I was also very fortunate that. We were fortunate in that the cost of living was not that high. All of us could, if you really work hard, you could get by without much. Because in those days, we rented a room, so we didn't have to buy anything. So we rented a room, so there was no, you don't need a down payment, which would have set us back. So we rented rooms, we studied as hard as we could, because that was the only for us to improve ourselves socially and economically. So I studied hard, and it was good that I didn't have, although I helped out in the family, by the time my older siblings were doing more of the help, and they were, by the time I was in central, some of them have started working and they contributed to the family upkeep and maintenance. So we didn't have to wash, my mother didn't have to wash clothes for other people when I was in my secondary school. So that was what helped, and we were fortunate, cost of living was low, and we could have the scholarships to go everywhere.
So what were the highs and lows of your time in the civil service?
My highest and lowest point,
in the civil service appointment, and really the recognition when I was chosen by Dr. Goh Keng Swee to be his aide, principal aide, to go to Sri Lanka to advise the president of Sri Lanka. And I think as a young officer, that happened when I was only 26, 27, that to be working next to the Dr. Goh Keng Swee, the architect of Singapore's economic modernization, that was a great achievement for you. I felt so proud to be chosen by him personally to help him, and I worked with him so closely. I saw him four or five times a day, and you just could just learn so much from that man and on his economics, and that helped to shape my view about economic development as well.
What about your political career? When did you first come out of to start your political career?
Well, the GE 2011 was really the turning point for me personally as well, because it I have been talking so much about politics, about happiness with the government policies, and I decided finally to step forward and to engage the government, to engage the people in the political arena. And that's a bold step for me personal, because I exposed myself to public scrutiny, not only what I say, what I do, and everything else. So that was quite a bold step. And after the GE, when this opportunity comes up for presidential election, it was not that difficult a choice to step forward as well. It's just that what do I want? I want a real contest, not a token contest. A token contest would be someone which does not fulfill the mission of the elected president, which is to have an independent president to provide proper checks and balances. And I saw three candidates, all of them having relationship, deep emotional relationship with the ruling party. I said, that's not on, and I should come out. And I did examine whether I did qualify, and I studied the Article 19.2C very carefully, and I thought that I could qualify, because there was a little known subsection, not known to most people, that really give you, it's only the Chief Justice, the Permanent Secretary, the Attorney General, Auditor General who could qualify, and the chairman and set boards, and chairman or CEO of companies with paid-up capital of 100 million. So there was a fourth section which I did study, and I thought there was a grey area which can be decided by the Presidential Election Committee. So, and I was able to convince them, and that was quite good. That once I have found myself eligible to run, the next step is just to offer myself.
Is there anybody in particular that you can say is your inspiration, or from what did you get your inspiration from?
Inspiration, inspired by, I think my mother played a great role in my life, and she lived until she was 100, and she died only in February this year. And she had I've always lived with her except for 3 years when I went away to England to study. So that impact, she actually came from a relatively well-to-do family in China, but she slacked it out, and she became a washerwoman, and decided to bring five new children up her own.
Now, can you tell us why do you want to become Singapore's next elected president? What are your motivations for in this course of action?
Well, I really want the mission of the elected president to be fulfilled, and which is to provide checks and balances and to be a center of moral power. So, and I feel that none of the three candidates could perform that role, could do justice to the mission of the elected president.
You have declared yourself as the only true independent candidate. What advantage or disadvantage do you think this will give you?
Well, the advantage is obvious. It is to be true to the mission of the elected president, which is to provide checks and balances, to have an independent voice to provide checks and balances on the ruling party. And I make it clear, these three may have resigned from the party, but they still have deep emotional ties that have been built up over 20, 30 years of relationship. They have friends there, they live it, breathe PAP all their life. So how could you expect overnight that they change? They have a deep a breath of fresh air that is so distinct from the PAP flavor.
So I have not been a member, and well, I have interacted with people who are members of PAP, senior members of PAP. I've worked with them for them. But that's different. That's more than 20 years ago. I do not have that emotional time. For me, my times were as a civil servant implementing the policies decided by them. I had no emotional ties at all with them.
Another issue much discussed is about reaching out to younger voters. How do you plan to reach out to younger voters?
By talking to them, engaging with them, getting involved with what they do, and that's the only way. And I have very young children, so I'm concerned for the future too, and I want them to have something that they compete on with in Singapore on an equal footing with everyone else, that they are not disadvantaged by policies of discrimination or policies that bring in influx of foreigners and then compete unfairly with them. And obviously I want them to do not have such a stressful life. Thing I do not want, by the time they start working and starting their families, Singaporeans would have disowned the labor of being the unhappiest workers in the world and having the most stressful life. I think if I can play a part in reducing the stress level, in making Singapore a more hospitable place to live and work, I would have achieved that purpose. I'm very sad that a lot of my friends tell me that their children who have gone overseas to work, to study and work, are not going to come back. And that's very sad. To just not come back to their own country, it is such an emotional thing to do, you know. There's a lot of anger, frustration to turn back on one's own country. What disaster has this government brought to the people?
As elected president, what could you do to maybe reach out or help these younger voters and the rest of Singapore as well?
Well, it is really being a center of moral power to persuade the government of the day to put more resources to take care of the young. You know, the young, we have the lowest birth rate, and the young, I mean, it's mainly a cost of living issue. They don't get married in time, they don't have, and then by the time they got married, the biological clock is working against our women. So at most they have one child or two children. And and they can't go, you know, housing. You know, you want to set up a family, you want to have housing. You can't just live with your parents, you know, there's no privacy and all that. So you want to bring up your own family, your own children, your own way. I think we can help them out. And we can help them out in providing affordable housing. And by affordable housing, I really mean affordable housing, not something that you take 30-year loan to pay for. There is a lot we can do, you know, because a large part of the price of HDB flats is the result of land pricing. And land pricing is the government's prerogative. So obviously, if you think that, I do not regard it as raiding the reserves, as the Minister of Financial Development put it. You know, these are our own people, you know. You are just taking money away from them. Let's say a HDB 3-room flat costs 300,000. The construction costs 100,000 and land price is 200,000. These people have to take up loans for 30 years to pay back. I mean, it's unconscionable that they have to pay this thing. And what do you do with the 200,000? You put into reserves and then you invest in other people's future outside Singapore. You invest the reserves. What's the point? Why make life so stressful, so difficult for your own people, and then use the money to invest, the money that caused their unhappiness, their stress, to invest on other people's future? I just don't see the logic of it all.
There also seems to be a clear divide between voters in the previous general elections, those that voted for the PAP and those that voted for the opposition. This divide may only grow wider. How do you think, as president, you can help heal this divide?
Well, I think the division is mainly caused by the economic difficulties, the economic disparities, the wide income gap between the rich and the poor, and obviously a lot of people benefited from PAP's economic policy, from the government's economic policy. A lot of people also do not benefit, in fact suffer, because a lot of them have their salaries
reduced because of foreign competition. A waitress walked up to me that she used to earn $1,500 a month 5 years ago. Now she's earning only $800. I mean, what is this progress and why? Because her jobs have been taken away or have been filled by cheaper, younger girls from China who come become waitresses. I mean, it's not fair to our people to have that kind of thing. So economic difficulty is one thing. I want to engage the government in coming out with a new economic consensus that will put the happiness of our people at the heart of the policies. And that is what I intend to do. And if for certain like other social areas like disadvantaged children, I would like to give them a good and equal start with children from wealthy families. And that is by subsidizing preschool, instituting a compulsory free school, preschool, which is not available now. And so it's not subsidized at all and it's expensive. I would like the government to provide this. Smaller classes, for example, build more schools, more places for undergraduates in university. So if this, especially the first part about providing greater resources for disadvantaged people, if the government is not prepared to put the resources, I think, and use the moral office, the prestige of the office of the president to raise money for it. And it's helping the elderly, helping the young, and that can be done.
Pardon me for being blunt, but some people have had the perception that you are hot-headed, and some have even said that you are a hooligan. Your thoughts on this?
Well, obviously, there are terms used by opponents or camps in the opponents, and those who wish me well and those who know me do not think so. You should listen to Dr. Ang Yong Wan's speech on Tuesday night, because he knew me for more than 40 years. But frankly speaking, if I had been hot-headed, if I had been a hooligan, would I have come this far in my career? I did very well in the civil service, I did very well in international banks, which you can't, it's not a dictatorial, you can't become a CEO by being a dictator, you know, that's not the way MNCs operate. They want people who are consensual, who believe there is this thing called the 360 degrees management style, where everybody ranks you, assesses you, and thinks how well you are before you get promoted. So that is the kind. If I had been a hooligan, I would not have made it in the corporate world. I mean, unless it's the mafia world, you know? So it's not. It's a corporate world. It's not a mafia world. And the corporate world has no place for hooligans, for hot-headed people.
According to media sources, you played a contributory role in Bank Peregrine's demise. And it was said that it was due to your poor judgment. Your comments on this?
I have already answered that in my reply to both the media and the online site. And basically, the person has got facts wrong. Peregrine's bank collapse was due to a loan, a fixed income loan, or the author call it investment, $300 million to a taxi company. I forgot the name, I think Steady and Fast or whatever. So it was a fixed income loan, and that did not come under me because I deal with equities. So fixed income didn't come under me. It was handled directly by the fixed income desk and the Jakarta office. The Singapore office was not involved at all. So to say that I contributed to the collapse is wrong, because I resigned, in fact, several months, 6 to 9 months before Peregrine's collapse. So I was no longer there, and I never handled handed the taxi company's loan, which contributed. They say is that because it triggered off a lot of cross default crosses. So if that is the cause, I was not involved. Any other causes that contributed to collapse of Bank of the Parent, well, I already resigned 6 to 9 months before that.
So Mr. Tan, if I may ask, why did you wait so long between your resignation as principal private secretary to Goh Chok Tong to now in standing up for Singaporeans?
Well, I worked in a bank. If you work for other people, it's not easy. It's difficult to come out to be in politics. Banks, most organizations, big organizations, MNCs, they have this particular clause that you do not engage yourself in politics. So now that I'm on my own, I have that flexibility.
Recently at DOC's face-to-face forum, you butted heads with fellow presidential candidate, Dr. Tony Tan, yeah. over the issues surrounding the Internal Security Act and its use against the alleged Marxist conspirators. Can you tell us why you felt you had to react in such a way?
Well, I thought a lot of people said, I thought the question should be directed on Dr. Tony Tan, who actually interrupted me, and he had his chance of talking a lot, giving his views on the ISA, about his claims of collective responsibility. He cannot say anything because it's covered by OSA. He was given so much time to talk, and when I spoke, and hardly what, two or three sentences had passed, and he interjected in a very loud voice. Everybody could hear it. If there was an outburst, that was it, an outburst from him. And I have to answer that, because this, if you want to have a dignified contest, you should not have an outburst in the first place, and with a rude remark, and you want to claim dignity for the office, you should just do honor to that claim. So I don't think I exercise my right of reply, and if you think that there was any rudeness, it should be directed at the person who started it all.
Well, you were principal private secretary to Goh Chok Tong when the alleged Marxist conspirators were detained in 1987. What was your role in this, if any? And did you believe the government's version of events at that time? How about now?
Well, I think I was not involved because, as you know, the whatever security matters went directly to the minister. So it's between the ISD, and so I did not have any hand in that, and that is the way it worked out in the government. So what I know is also what you know to read from the press. That's it. That's what the government think. They do not have got good reasons. But interacting with the people who are church workers gave me a sense that they are not violent. To say that they are plotting a violent overthrow, I find it difficult to believe, right? This is just based on interacting with these people. They are quite soft people, do-gooder social workers. It is hard to believe that they are engaged in a violent overthrow.
You have been closely affiliated with Singapore Democratic Party, SDP, as you contested as a candidate from that party in Holland Bukit Timah GRC in the previous general elections. Do you see your ties to an opposition party as an advantage or disadvantage to you?
I think the SDP, I don't think it is a lot of people say that it's a disadvantage, but it is not, because it allows me to articulate my views and on certain matters which are not the monopoly of SDP. The views are shared by a lot of people, even people in the PAP too, my economic views. So I don't see that as being specific to SDP. So these are views shared by people all over the country. So it is not a disadvantage. As well, whether it is also a disadvantage, people say that, well, you can't really claim to be independent when you have been a member, so you have an associate political. I think we should examine what the word independence mean in this context. It's independence of the ruling party. Because it is the ruling party that you need to check on. So, and SDP, the ruling party is the PAP, so SDP has never formed the government at all.
One last question, Mr. Tan. There have been calls for a more open, inclusive society in Singapore. How do you think the president can help contribute to this?
More inclusive society? Yeah, I think we should... Inclusive meaning you must include everybody in your economic progress, social progress, and you should not leave anybody behind. I think to do that, you have to address the economic disparities that have arisen from our economic policy, giving assistance, helping those who have been disadvantaged by the economic policies, and supporting the programs. And I'm quite prepared to do that, because this unity is caused by unhappiness, and unhappiness is economic in nature.
In light of your recent campaign, is there anything you'd like to say to readers of TOC?
Well, I think TOC has played a useful role in, I think the social media is an important vehicle to reach out, given the limited coverage for some of us. we don't have the natural advantage of other people who have been famous before because of the high profile in the past. So I think it's important that the social media being what it is, a vehicle that allows for participation from viewers, is really good. I mean, that is the kind of thing that we want, and I hope we can be more active in.
Mr. Tan, thank you for your time. On behalf of the Online Citizen, we wish you all the best.
Pleasure.